sleep apnea is incredibly deadly, because what it does is, what happens in sleep apnea is the tongue falls back. As you put your head back or to the side, it falls back. Patients that have sleep apnea, their spouse, bed partner knows, and even very often in their cases, they know they'll wake up gasping, like they couldn't breathe, like they were suffocating, because they literally were suffocating. When you put your head back, boom, the tongue falls back. It's like a cork or a flapper on a toilet. It seals up the airway. When someone does CPR, one of the first things they do is they say it's ABC. You want it, first thing you do is check the airway. And when you check the airway, you tilt the head like this. By tilting the head like that, you're moving the tongue away and opening up the airway. Because very often, the tongue has fallen back and alone blocks the airway. In many cases, once you do that, the patient starts breathing again. That's why that's always the first step. Well, you can imagine, if the tongue falls back, and the definition of one apneic event is when the tongue falls back, boom, blocks the airway for anywhere from 10 to over 120 seconds. I actually had a patient come in the other day. They stopped breathing for 131 seconds. That's more than 2 minutes. I said, I need you to do me an example. Do me a favor, please. I need you to hold your breath here. I need to see how long you can hold your breath for. 37 seconds is the most he could hold his breath for. Yet while he was sleeping at night, he stopped breathing for 131 seconds. What kind of brain damage do you think that's causing? Why do you think they're now starting to link Alzheimer's to sleep apnea? Here's some other data that's just mind, it's shocking. You're four times the risk of having a stroke, three times the risk of heart disease and a heart attack. But if you go on the internet, you'll see there's now studies that are showing 73.8% of the people that get a stroke have untreated sleep apnea. Now, I don't know if you understand what that correlation is, but that means almost three out of four people that get a stroke have untreated sleep apnea. Well, what if we could get rid of untreated sleep apnea? We could cure sleep apnea. Could we get rid of 75% of the strokes? Could we get rid of 30% of the strokes? How tremendous would that be? When someone has untreated sleep apnea, it's like being a walking time bomb. To give you a better example or an idea, moderate sleep apnea is when you have one of these apneic events where you stop breathing for 10 seconds to 130 seconds, where that happens 30 times an hour, what we call AHI, or apnea hypopneic index. You stop breathing for at least 10 seconds, 30 times an hour, and that's only moderate sleep apnea. That's once every 2 minutes. Once every 2 minutes. Well, what do you think is going on when you stop breathing once every 2 minutes? Are you getting any kind of sleep? That's why it's such a, there's 100,000 car accidents every single year due to drowsy driving. 60 Minutes has done studies where in those studies, they compared someone who was legally drunk to someone who didn't get any REM sleep the night before. Guess who you'd rather have on the road with you? The person who's legally drunk. Now the DOT, Department of Transportation, is working on legislation for mandatory sleep studies for all truck drivers. Anyone with a truck driver's license, mandatory sleep study. They're looking at a lot of the major accidents in Valencia, California, a year ago. Major, major truck accident. Closed the 5 freeway for, I think it was a few weeks, because this huge fire that it caused in the rain at night. Probably drowsy driving was one of the causes. The Exxon Valdez, they think component could have been drowsiness at the helm of the ship. They're now looking at this to a much greater extent because we're realizing the impact this has on everyday life for everybody. This is significant.